Hello, welcome to Rohde & Schwarz 35. My name is Jörg Köpp. I'm Market Segment Manager at Rohde & Schwarz for Wireless Communication, especially Internet of Things Wireless Communication. Today I would like to share with you some latest trends about wireless in industrial Internet of Things, a kind of new term, in fact an old term, but actually quite hyped. Because everyone is more or less talking about this, how we can use wireless technology in the industrial environment and smart factories and so on, and also driven a little bit by related 5G discussions. What I would like to do today is to give you some insights what this IIoT and especially wireless IoT is about, what are the drivers, what are the technologies that we see, and of course also at the end a little bit what are our test solutions from Rohde & Schwarz for this purpose. Let's start with a kind of introduction. Where is this term Industry 4.0 coming from? Essentially, it is coming from this famous industrial revolutions, the first industrial revolution with water and steam power, then the second one with electrical energy, third one then electronics coming in, and then the fourth industrial revolution already 10 years ongoing. Probably we have to talk about the fifth now. Based on cyber physical systems, Internet of Things, big data, artificial intelligence, and so on, and so on, and so on. And Industry 4.0 is a kind of term which was initially defined by research projects founded by the German government, where the German government and research organization were thinking about how the future of smart factory, smart business processes, and so on could look like, and how communication can help to improve and to reach the related target. And this is more or less the term Industry 4.0 coming from, also already 10 years old. Just for this presentation, I was trying to draw a little bit a picture with the different areas and different terms that we can sort this a little bit out, at least from my point of view. Probably you would draw this in a different way. You will probably also have different sizes of boxes. This should not matter here. It's more or less giving a little bit a picture of what we are talking about, a kind of landscape, as I said, from my point of view. I mentioned already this Industry 4.0, which is a nice definition here from the European Parliament related to this kind of stuff. There are also related organizations around this Industry 4.0. Stuff and also an Open Industry 4.0 Alliance, where you could probably also find some stuff. Then we have the whole area of Internet of Things, and there are a kind of touch points between the Industry 4.0 and the Internet of Things. And this is, for example, in the area of smart factories, so everything what is on the factory floor. And here we have this part, which is this red part here, what I would say is the industrial Internet of Things. If you look on Internet of Things, there's of course other applications like smart cities, smart mobility, and so on and so far. And here, by the way, there's also an industrial Internet consortium which taking care about this part. This just to setting the scene about the different terms that we probably use in this presentation. If you are looking now on connectivity in the IoT or on the smart factory, then we have to recognize that over the last, let's see, 30, 40 years, connectivity was more or less dominated in the factory floor by field buses. And they still have a large portion on the factory floors, based on some forecast today around 40%. There was a kind of move of these field buses to industrial Ethernet. You see this also, there was Profibus, which is quite common field bus, everyone knows, which is now brought to the industrial internet area by and called now Profinet. You see this in other stuff as well. So industrial Ethernet is what is the dominant technology and still growing technology on the smart factory floor. And of course, there are a little bit wireless technology for certain functions. And there are technologies like Wi-Fi, like Bluetooth, RFID, which was initially, by the way, the first IIoT or IoT technology. So the term IoT was born based on an RFID applications some years ago. And there are some specific technologies like ISA 100, Wireless Heart, which are dedicated for this industrial applications, not only in a factory, also some other industrial applications. And of course, cellular technology could be LTE, could be GSM, and so on, is already used for certain applications in the smart factory or IoT environment. Now, with the third industrial revolution, Industry 4.0 derives also some changes in manufacturing. And one of the trends that we actually see is that they try to move, at least for certain applications, for wireless connectivity, because factories need to become much more flexible, a kind of mobile, because you probably have to change very often your factory environment, and you have not this factory lines which are built in stone anymore, and therefore it might make much more sense if it is possible to use wireless technologies. There are more and more things that you need to be connected. You have more this kind of tracking, traffic of goods, traffic of access, trying to track where your tools are, and so on and so forth. So a lot more applications in this regard where wireless makes a lot of sense. This kind of flexibility requires a drive as a move to wireless technologies. But of course, if you bring this in an operational environment in a factory, then you have certain requirements, especially about the performance, the reliability, the security, and the availability, this 24 hours, 7 days a week, 365 days the year, very important. But as you see here in forecast from ABI Research, it is expected that in the next 10 years, wireless will be the kind of dominating technologies in terms of how many devices are detected. Not saying these are all machines, these are all also these tools, assets, and so on and so far. So I expecting, so they are in this range of 4 billion connected devices in the year 2030. So what are the applications? I mentioned already some where probably wireless makes a lot of things. Tracking of your tools, anything about asset management, for example, these door locks and so on, where probably nice to open this. You have probably more and more sensors are seen here on this picture. You can do this via cable, but if you would like to deploy this, it is probably much easier to do this wireless. Then we see not only smartphones in our private world, there are also this kind of handhelds on a factory floor for different purposes. We see also more and more this kind of glasses, virtual reality, augmented reality, and then of course the new stuff, the robots, probably mobile robots, robots interacting with humans, and this guided vehicles. All this kind of stuff could really leverage wireless technology, makes it much easier to use this. Some are really need wireless technologies. So good so far, but one of the main things that we have to have in mind in the factory floor today, and here I have taken on the right-hand side a nice picture, I think it was from Siemens, about an Ethernet switch. This is really protected by hardware for any kind of access. So it's really like a network castle. Nobody can break in there, even by mechanical protection. If we are coming from mobile, from the wireless mold, it looks like more this. We would like to have open access everywhere to the wireless network, to the mobile network, would like to use it immediately with any device. And this is a kind of clash, as you can see. And if you would like to use a standard wireless technology in this kind of castle, then you have to be careful and have to think about a couple of things, how to make this secure, reliable, and so on and so forth. So this is the big advantage or the big challenge for the wireless technology, even if they have this couple of advantages. So what are the main requirements if you would like to bring any connectivity technology on the factory floor, and especially also for wireless? I call this a magic triangle of communication in a smart factory. It is about latency, it is about reliability, it is about security. Security is of course a must, and security, especially in wireless, doesn't only mean this typical stuff like supervising the traffic on the networks via DPI, deep packet inspection engine, having firewalls, and so on and so far. It is even if you think about it, probably somebody comes with a jammer close to the factory and destroys your radio on air, you can destroy also or damage the communication on the factory floor. So a couple of aspects which are related to security and safety. Reliability is of course essential. I mentioned already it should work all the day, very reliable. And latency, yeah, this depends a little bit on the requirement. You have of course some applications where you have really control loops from machine to machine, where you have strong latency requirements. For other applications, also in a smart factory, it's probably not so important, but for certain things it is, of course. If we are now looking, what are wireless technologies which could be applicable in the factory, then you have more or less everything which is also relevant for the wireless Internet of Things. And I've taken this picture here, which shows a little bit the different areas, dependent if you are in a wide area, the neighbor network, local area, or even in the body area network. And you see here a lot of different technologies, which is sometimes a little bit confusing, sometimes also frustrating if you would like to select the right one. But essentially, all these technologies have some advantages, disadvantages, that are optimized for some certain application. I mean, we use, for example, Bluetooth low energy everywhere, Zigbee thread, especially in buildings, mesh network, Wi-SUN, more in a kind of smart grid application, C-Wave, a certain application, N-Ocean, you name it. So there's a couple of them, and I'm quite sure you can use one or the other also based on the applications that you have in the Smart Factory IIoT environment. But let's have a look on some certain technologies where we also see actually the trend that they like to prepare for to enter the IoT and also the IIoT market. So one example is Wi-Fi. You see here more or less the graph for the main Wi-Fi standards. What we normally using on our laptops and mobiles is more or less this Wi-Fi 11ac, in the future Wi-Fi 11ax, and if you go to Wi-Fi 7, probably Wi-Fi 11be. I will not go into detail, but there are also some specific standards already defined some years ago for the IoT market, which are probably also interesting for the IIoT market. One is 802.11AF. This is already a standard operating in the sub gigahertz band. Here it was mainly the intention to have more coverage and to use free TV channels. So that's the TV white space applications. More interesting, a little bit later, I think, was 802.11AH, which has also the marketing name Wi-Fi Hello. And this was dedicated for the IoT market, and I will show you in a minute, has also some impact on the latest standard 802.11ax. What was Wi-Fi 11ax about? Key drivers was really to have extended range. So also using, for example, Wi-Fi outside, even they were thinking about extended range VLAN, VLAN outside, utility network, something like this. And you see here also industry automation. Low power is, of course, if you are talking about IoT, battery power devices, and very important thing, they were requesting or targeting to have a much higher number or large number of devices per access point, because here it is not so much about how much traffic you can handle, it's more about how many devices you can handle. And okay, there was a kind of requirement to have higher throughput than compared, for example, to Zigbee or Wi-SUN. But it was here not the question to have, as for other Wi-Fi standards, the kind of support of legacy stuff. So it was a real greenfield approach. Just some certain features which are defined in 802.11ah. Besides this, that they were going in the sub gigahertz range, which is already quite an advantage if you think about better coverage and range, they introduced also what they call dual carrier modulation. I have tried to draw this here. What dual carrier modulation means, normally you have a certain number of bits, like 6 bits here, you make a coding, then you have probably in this one to two coding, you have 12 bits that you would like to transmit, but then you split virtually the subcarriers that you have on the left hand side, you take the bits as they are, and on the other side, you are doing the same thing. So there is a kind of redundancy that you bring in here and also a kind of diversity because you are transmitting the same information, essentially the 6 bits, 4 times because of the coding, and on different frequencies. That means also in this sense it becomes more stable. So this was one thing for better range, which is probably also interesting in a factory environment. Then they have an additional feature which is about low power. Low power is always a kind of topic in IoT, especially if you have a battery powered. Here on the left-hand side, you see just a normal behavior of an access point and the station. The access point gets some data and would like to send it out. The station has to go from time to time in the receiving mode to look whether they have some data. If they see, oh, there is some data, they go in the receiving mode and get the data. In Wi-Fi 11AH, and by the way, a feature which was also taken over by Wi-Fi 11AX was kind of target wait time. That means the station for low power consumption and assuming latency and responsiveness is not an issue has defined a kind of sleep time or target wait time. So that means the access point knows that the station is actually sleeping and buffers content for the station and knows, okay, in this time window, the station will go in the receiving mode and I can send this out. This is a great power saving feature. And even more, there's a dedicated study group in Wi-Fi, the 802.11BA, which is now defined in wake-up radio. By the way, a feature that we also see now in narrowband IoT and LTE-M in the cellular world. What is the idea here? The idea here is that you can still save power, but you have not the problem with this latency as on the left-hand side. How you can solve this? You solve this by implementing on the station side a kind of low power receiver, a kind of wake up radio, and the access point before he would like to send something to you, he is sending a special signal which is recognized by this low power receiver. And if the low power receiver sees this wake up signal or wake up radio, then he switched on the full receiver and can get the data. So dedicated features for low power consumption. If you look for Wi-Fi 11AX, just shortly, what are the main features and what are the features also interesting for this factory environment? There's, of course, more bandwidth with 1024 QAM, probably interesting for this industry applications if you would like to have high bandwidth. There is this long OFDM symbols. This is especially done for outdoor environment and for multipath environment. Could be, or I think, I'm quite sure, it has some advantages for this industrial environment as well, because here you have a very strong multipath environment. This goes together with the longer guard intervals, which you see here on the left-hand side. Then OFDMA. Yeah, this is now what I always call the revolution of Wi-Fi 11EX. This, at the end of the day, allows resource control and also reservation of resources for different users, which of course helps a lot. Then we have here this multi-user MIMOs, more about this. This dual carrier modulation, what I mentioned before from Wi-Fi 11AH, is also available for Wi-Fi 11AX. For higher deployment, there's this coloring for the interworking on different access points. Quite interesting, and the target wait time I mentioned already. What does it mean? Some years ago, they have developed Wi-Fi 11AH with certain features for the IoT market. And I would say the most important feature from them, they have taken over in the latest common Wi-Fi or mainstream Wi-Fi standard, Wi-Fi 11AX as well. And I can say you, if you go more in the direction of Wi-Fi 7, Wi-Fi 11BE, you will even see more features which help a lot in this environment, especially if you think about reliability and low latency. Wi-Fi. There's another famous technologies that we are using everywhere, more or less, at least in our wearable devices, smartphones, and so on and so far. And also Bluetooth Low Energy has made some big steps in the direction to support the IoT market. And some of these features, I think, are also relevant for the IIoT market. Just quickly, what they introduced, higher speed, just with a higher symbol rate. This is simple. Again, here, similar stuff like I described for Wi-Fi, this higher range by FCC coding and so on and so far. Broadcasting, this is more interesting in the factory environment if you would like to make tracking and location services. This is related to the advertising channel. They have also introduced mesh network, and this is, of course, if you think about coverage, especially coverage in the factory hall, also quite interesting applications. Actually, I think we see the most application, at least I see the most application in the smart lighting environment, but of course, also in the factory, smart lighting could make a lot of sense. Then for this kind of tracking and finding of goods, they have introduced new features for direction finding. Angel of arrival, angel of departure. Could be an alternative to ultra wideband, depends a little bit what accuracy you need for this direction finding. Then they introduced something in the latest standard for Bluetooth, Bluetooth 5.0, also for power control, and also something low energy audio. And this doesn't sound like a feature for industrial environment, but let's see. If you look on this, first of all, shortly, what is in release 5.1, this direction finding. You have, of course, this kind of proximity already for years, which is more or less on the RSSI level. If you have more, you can also make a kind of positioning. Now they introduce this angel of arrival, angle of arrival, and angle of departure. How this looks like, they have introduced here a kind of constant tone, which is attached to any Bluetooth package, if you would like to use this. And then you have a transmitter who's receiving this specific packets, and you have a receiver. The receiver has an RF switch with a couple of antennas, at least two. And based on the phase difference that you can measure on this different signals on these antennas, you can make this angle of arrival measurements, simple calculation. We notice the same thing, for example, from ultra wideband as well. Then they have power control. Two things, they have the possibility to adjust the receiving power and also to adjust the transmit power, and they have introduced a certain protocol for this. Adjust the receiving power is more or less so that a receiver can make sure that he has just the power that he would like to have from a communication partner. So typically they have a kind of golden area where they have the best performance related to the received signal. And they would like to have, as they communicate with different communication partners, from all these partners receiving on the same level. And here they have the possibility to ask the transmitter to adapt to a certain level. And if he's able to do so, he can adjust, and then the situation becomes much better. The other thing is that he asked a communication partner, because he would like to save power, the transmitter, and would like to receive the transmit power. But for this, he has to ask the communication partner to which level he can do this. And for this, they have this protocol. And then if this is possible, he allows, for example, you can reduce this by 1 dB. It is still enough power to decode the signal. Then he can adjust this kind of power saving features. And then they introduced this audio codecs. This is probably not so interesting, just in case you would like to bring some music to your workers, then this as well, of course. But what they introduced also for audio communication, audio streaming, audio broadcasting, is an isochronous channels, and this allows communication in time-bounded data. And communication of time-bounded data, this sounds a little bit interesting also for a couple of IoT applications. So let's see. I'm quite sure there will be some creative people which will use this new Bluetooth feature also in this industrial environment. So this was just a couple of examples to give you an idea that there's, of course, a lot of wireless standards, some really optimized for the industrial environment, but also some kind of common standards which have some features which are typically not so well known, but which could help a lot if you would like to bring or use this kind of technologies in the IoT space or on the factory floor. Here's the same build that picture that we saw before with these different applications and typical wireless technologies that you can use for. For example, if you would like to connect your tools, Bluetooth and Wi-Fi is not so bad. For locks, opening this Bluetooth and ultra-wideband, of course. Asset tracking, ultra-wideband or RFID. Then for sensors, there is of course Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, but also cellular technologies like Narrowband IoT. Or why not taking LoRaWAN, also a very interesting application or technology, especially if you run this on your private network. Then this handhelds, of course, you need here a little bit more bandwidth, so Narrowband IoT would probably not the right stuff, but you can use again Wi-Fi or cellular technology like 5G or 4G today. Similar with glasses, and also if you go to robots and so on. You can use these different technologies. Some already today, 5G technology, probably soon. So, a lot of things. And as I mentioned, 5G, we should think about why 5G is so attractive for the IoT market. I think the main advantage is if you have one of our first pictures in mind, you have a lot of different wireless technologies which always probably fit to exactly one use case. The nice thing on this new wireless standard 5G is that it is so flexible that you can run basically with one standard, with one base technology, which is 5G. All these different applications. Based, normally we describe this on this famous triangle of 5G communication. I have drawing this here a little bit different, but you have all these features related to massive machine-type communication with flavors like Narrowband IoT, LTE-M, power saving, and so on and so far, enhanced coverage. You have all these eMBB features with different bandwidth that you can use for all this application. And we have this new stuff which is called ultra reliability, low latency communication with certain features for low latency for reliability. But this is all supported with one technology. And even more interesting now that you can run this, for example, in Germany, on your own non-public network. So you run your own network in 5G, for example, and can more or less say how you would like to use this 5G network, how you can split, for example, your available spectrum via virtualization for these different applications and can manage and control this by your own. Or with the help of an operator, of course, but based on your very dedicated requirement. You are not dependent on the common deployment. You can just optimize this for your purpose. And especially if you're looking on this ultra reliability, low latency communication, I think there's anyway a dedicated webcast from my colleague Mike about this. But just shortly, what you have in 5G for this to again address this magic triangle, latency, reliability, and security is a kind of toolbox. It is not the case that you say, oh, I would like to have now 5G low latency and press a button and this has this kind of feature. It's not so easy. It's a lot more complicated, but at least from the standard and standardization point of view, you have a couple of things how you can optimize your application or the 5G for your application. For example, you have a very flexible timing. You can work with short symbol times. You can work with mini slots. You have a flexible TDD uplink, downlink, symbol assignment. You have a much more flexible scheduling now with very fast hard processes. You can make semi-persistent scheduling, preemption, which helps very much for low latency communication. You can have this end-to-end optimization by local processing, virtualization, local processing in a sense from mobile edge computing, for example. Virtualization that you have dedicated slots for certain services and all this kind of quality of service capabilities with traffic prioritization end-to-end and so on. And of course, something about reliable transmission, more robust coding on the air, that you have more repetitions, that you have repetitions from the beginning, that you have diversity, you are using communications, to, kind of redundant communication to several base stations at the same time, or also communicating or using different spectrum and so on and so forth. So a lot of things that you can do there. But again, it is a kind of toolbox, and you have to look how you can use this kind of toolbox for your applications. But it's quite exciting. It is probably the first time that we have one wireless standard, which is at least from the standardization point of view, able to meet all these different requirements for the different applications, in this case for the factory floor. Just to come or to mention one thing, we talked a lot about low latency. In fact, in this factory floor, it is not only about low latency, this is very helpful. Much more important that is that you have a kind of deterministic latency, that you can say, okay, I would like to switch on another machine exactly at this time. And it doesn't matter so much that this is in 99% of cases switched on after 1 millisecond, it is important that it is always switched on after 2 milliseconds. Something like this. And for this, already defined, especially for Ethernet-based networks, by the IEEE, is this called time-sensitive networks, which is about deterministic communication with common sense of time. Common sense of time means, as you see in all these clocks, all these parts of the network and the endpoint of the networks are time-synchronized so that they feel also all on the same time and you can really work with this deterministic thing. Target is to enable a guaranteed data transfer over LAN WAN. So the definition is essentially independent from the physical layer. You can use this for a wireline technology, also for a wireless technology. Bounded low latency, low delay variation, and extreme low loss. So that's also quality of service. On the left-hand side, you see a couple of standards which are related to this time-sensitive network. Why I mentioned this? I mentioned this because this is also a kind of target for 5G to be part or to be supporting this time-sensitive networks. For example, a 5G is then working as a kind of bridge, transparent bridge in a time TSN network. So quite interesting thing how you can see how wireless technologies try to adapt to the needs from the market, just as example. Finally, this was what I would like to share with you, what I'm actually thinking about this industrial Internet of Things. Just a couple of information, there's of course much more to say about, but I would not close until I was also giving you the message that for the IoT and also the, of course, the IIoT market, we have a couple of test solutions, which is our main business, of course, for all the RF design, verification, conformance testing, end-to-end testing, protocol conformance, all this kind of interference, for example, interference between the different technology, could be in-device interference or in the office. There's also something about verifying secure IP communications, for example, with the help of DPI engines, also verification of the security of your end devices. Low power design, battery lifetime optimization is a big issue. And of course, network scanning, optimization, and benchmarking. So we have here already also new features, especially for this low latency stuff and quality of service, even using artificial intelligence and so on and so forth to address this kind of market. So this was all this afternoon for you, for me, about this IIoT stuff. I hope this was interesting for me, for you. Stay tuned and all the best. Stay healthy, stay safe. Thank you very much.